Let us then bring in Melanie Plageman. She is helping us sort of round out our third period of the show today. So excellent, excellent. How you doing?
Good. How are you?
I'm doing well. It's been good so far.
For people who don't know Melanie, Melanie is a senior software engineer at Microsoft, and she's a Postgres hacker and Postgres contributor.
And just for those who don't pay attention to the Postgres commits, which maybe is a larger number of people than you might expect, she recently contributed pgstat.io into Postgres 16. Fingers crossed that will be available later this year. And I guess that's a big part of what you're going to talk about today.
Yep, it is.
Observability in Postgres. And I know people are really excited about pgstat.io, so let's find out why. Take it away, Melanie.
Yeah, so this talk is going to be great for users that are already comfortable doing some amount of tuning and want to kind of take it to the next level. And so that's really who it's targeted at. So I'm going to talk about the difference between sort of the existing IO statistics that are available in Postgres and what pgstat.io can offer in terms of observability. Just about me, I'm a Postgres hacker working at Microsoft on the open source Postgres team. The last 2 years, I've been very focused on IO performance and IO benchmarking. But before that, I've worked on a lot of the other subsystems in Postgres, like planner and executor and things like that. So users have pretty much two main goals for their transactional workload IO performance. They care about throughput and they care about latency, right? So you want high TPS and low latency, low tail latency. That's when you're thinking about performance, those are the things that really matter. You can boil everything down to that. But some of the impediments to that, I mean, the most sort of obvious one is if your data is not in shared buffers. So if your data is either too large for shared buffers and you don't expect it to fit, or you've misconfigured shared buffers, then you're going to see more IO. And that can be a common performance issue, the cause of common performance issue. Another one is issues around wall IO and checkpointer misconfiguration. That's a pretty common reason that people are seeing IO bottlenecks. And then auto vacuum. Tuning auto vacuum is notoriously finicky, and it really depends on your workload, and the out of the box settings are going to be good for no one, basically. So, you know, if your auto vacuum's not running frequently enough, if you're not, if there's the workers aren't being aggressive enough, that kind of thing. So, as we think about tuning, these kind of are bucketed into different areas. So you can tune shared buffers. There are different Postgres GUCs around the background writer, around checkpointer and wall tuning, and around auto vacuum. I'm not going to get too much into checkpointer and auto vacuum. I'm primarily going to focus on what sort of data we can use to indicate if we need to make a change to shared buffers or to background writer configuration. And as we think about tuning, you know, the ideal is that you're data driven. So you want to base tuning decisions on actually what's happening in the database. And so how do you get that information? So one option is to use operating system statistics and utilities, so like using IOSTAT and other. There's a, you know, different extensions in Postgres that'll give you access to some operating system information about IO. But the kind of the first place, the most obvious place that you would go is the existing IO statistics in Postgres. So pgstat database is going to give you per database statistics on reads and writes, hits and, read and write time, hits and reads. There's pgstat IO all tables and indexes. There's pgstat BG writer. And then many, many users are using the pgstat statements extension, which is going to give you a fair amount of information. But we wanted to add pgstat.io because there's actually substantial gaps in these existing IO statistics that are in Postgres, and even those that are in extensions. And so what we really needed to do was actually make changes to where we're collecting statistics and not just what we're revealing and bubbling up, but actually, what are we actually collecting? And so we focused, I think you can kind of think of the three areas or the three gaps that PGStat.io is addressing, and we can kind of break those down. So I think one of the most important ones is that in all of the existing IO statistics, writes are include flushes and extends. And I'm going to talk a little bit more about, okay, what is that anyway? And why does it matter? Another sort of the granularity is one of the main problems with the existing IO statistics. So all backend types, whether that's checkpointer, background writer, you know, whatever type of backend it is, those are all going to be included in the same statistics. You're not going to see it broken down. There's some amount of, there's some exceptions to that, but largely you're going to see it all together. And then also you're going to see IO for all different contexts. In context here, what I mean is, okay, vacuuming is different than just normal transactional workload IO. Doing a bulk read, doing bulk data loading, that's different, sort of a different IO pattern, a different reason for doing IO. And so you're going to want to address that differently when it comes to tuning. So this is just a snapshot, probably right after a little bit after I did a NITDB, so you can see a lot of it's zero, but this is what PGStat.io looks like. And you can see that we actually have read and write and fsync time. So that's cool. We can see the timing. And then we have some specific columns that are actually relevant for buffer access strategies, which I'll talk about a little bit later, like reuses. So that's just to give you a little picture of it. So let's go back to what I said about what are the gaps, right? So why do we care about counting flushes and extends separately? What is a flush? So in PGStat.io, we call flushes writes because we're able to distinguish writes from extends. In order to kind of talk about this, what I want to do is walk you through from an internals perspective, the update or insert, some of the same steps are pretty similar workflow in Postgres to give you an idea of like, what is different about an extend and why does it matter if it's separate and what does that tell us? So when you are, let's say you're going to just do an insert some data, first you have to find a place to put it. So your file for your relation is going to have, you know, blocks in it. And so you need to find a block that has some space available. And so that could be in the middle, it could be at the end. You're just looking for a block that has space for that data you're going to add. And if there isn't a block that already has space, you're going to need to extend the file to add another block to the file. And if you think about it, I mean, this is inevitable. You can't avoid this. If you have more data, eventually you're going to have to make the file bigger, right? So now that you've sort of identified which block you want to actually in the file, you want to actually add your data to, you have to get it into shared buffers. So first you'll check, okay, is it already in shared buffers? If it's already in shared buffers, that's a cache hit, right? A shared buffers hit, and we're done. So that counts as a hit. We need to do the read. And we can just add our data. However, if the block is not already in shared buffers, then we need to find a shared buffer to put it in. And the shared buffer that, in order to find a shared buffer to put it in, we might find one, and then actually that shared buffer is dirty. It has unrelated data in it that is not, you know, not necessarily data from our table, but we can't just throw it away because, you know, then we would lose the data. So before we can use that buffer, we have to write that data out. And that's a flush. And that will count as a write in PGStat.io. And you can see that here, if that buffer had already been free or clean, that it hadn't had dirty data in it, then we wouldn't have needed to do this write. So it's an avoidable write. Finally, we're going to read our block into the shared buffer. And now we have it and we can do our insert. And this write is not a write like, oh, it's a write out to kernel buffers or disk. This is just basically copying in our dirty data, our tuple, into that buffer. So what does this tell us about why it's important to count flushes and extends separately? What we saw was that the flush of the dirty data from an unrelated source was actually avoidable. If we had had a clean buffer, we wouldn't have needed to do it. Whereas the extend is something that is avoidable. I mean, is unavoidable. We're going to have to do extends as the file gets bigger. It's a consequence of our workload and not cleaning up someone else's mess, basically. So by separating them, we can allow ourselves to understand whether or not we actually have to tune something. We could see a lot of writes and say, oh, we probably need to increase shared buffers, but actually we're just doing a lot of extends. And this is something you might see, for example, if you're doing a bulk write, you're doing a copy from, you might see a ton of, in existing IO statistics, a ton of writes, but actually these are just copy from doing a bunch of extends. And this is not even data that's really part of your working set for your transactional workload necessarily. So tuning for that is going to be disadvantageous. I also mentioned earlier that we want to separate out IO by the context in which it's done and by backend type. And to talk about that and why that's important, I'm going to use as an example, auto vacuum IO workflow roughly. So auto vacuum and vacuum, but let's just specifically talk about auto vacuum, is going to identify, okay, what are the blocks that I need to vacuum, and then go through and do each one. So it might not be all the blocks in the relation, of course. So it identifies the next block to vacuum, and then it has to look for it, see if it's in shared buffers. If it's in shared buffers, then it can vacuum it. And it's also, that's a cache hit, right? So we didn't have to actually do IO. Now, this is what's this is where it gets different from the regular update insert workflow we were talking about. So if we need to actually do IO, so we need to go out and either and read in the block that we're going to vacuum, we need to find a shared buffer for it. That's the same as before. But the difference here is that vacuum is going to use a buffer access strategy. And what that means is that we are going to cap the number of, or so we're going to use a ring buffer with a certain number of buffers in it. And each time we need a new buffer, we're going to go around that ring and reuse buffers we've already used to vacuum previous blocks. And what this does is it keeps us from using up all of shared buffers just to vacuum, because that'll wash out all of our working set from shared buffers. We don't want that. And so the important thing is that when we're initially finding buffers to use, we do this lazily on demand. So we get a shared buffer, we evict it, which counts as an eviction in pgstat.io. And now we add it to the ring. Once we've filled up the ring, the next time we need a shared buffer, we're going to reuse a buffer that we've already used. And that counts as a reuse in pgstat.io. And when we reuse that buffer, we need to flush the dirty data that was there already, and we need to write out the associated wall up to the LSN that was associated with that data that we vacuumed. So what's important here is that even if there are clean shared buffers, we're not going to go and use them for that data we're vacuuming, because we're using this buffer access strategy. And then what we'll do is, read the block that we're trying to vacuum to begin with into the buffer that we've selected, vacuum it, and mark the buffer dirty. So what does this mean about why pgstat.io is useful? So auto vacuum is done by auto vacuum workers. So auto vacuum worker is a different backend type than a client backend. So we're able to see that IO pattern and that IO that's being done by auto vacuum separately in pgstat.io. And what you saw was that we're using this buffer access strategy, which is a separate pattern and going to show up separately than normal transactional workload working set. And we may be vacuuming relations that are not part of our working set. It's not the hottest data, and that's okay. So we don't necessarily want to tune our database to accommodate what we need to vacuum. So it's okay to, vacuum older data. We don't necessarily need to resize shared buffers so that all fits in shared buffers. And similarly, context matters. So Vacuum is also an IO context, so we can kind of see that separated out. But another example of that is a bulk read. So for example, if you do a large select, which is basically a relation with the, where the number of blocks is, you know, greater than shared buffers divided by four. So if we're doing a large select, we're going to be doing a lot of reads. And that data is not necessarily part of our working set. So we don't necessarily want to resize shared buffers so that that giant table can fit it. You might have a mixed workload with transactional queries alongside some type of analytical work. And so what we're trying to do is let's tune specifically for our transactional workload for that, that working set to fit in memory and to make that workload efficient. And then you can separately think about tuning for your analytical workload and make different considerations. If you know that a large part of your workload is not going to fit in shared buffers, you might want to actually decrease shared buffers because there are certain advantages to that. And I won't go into that more now, but... Now, given what I just talked about, I think it's useful to kind of take it back to pgstat.io and look at a few concrete examples and how it looks in the view. So I just mentioned that sometimes your workload is not going to fit in shared buffers. Like that's just a reality, might not even, you know, might not fit in memory. You have a large database. That's like pretty normal. So in that case, it might not be an option for you to increase shared buffers so that everything fits in shared buffers. But one thing that you do want to watch out for is that you still want to avoid client backends doing their own writes as much as possible. So in this example, you can see client backend normal relation writes is decently high. And we actually want that number to basically be zero because this is not a write in the sort of the sense of insert, update, whatever. This is actually the client looking for a buffer. It can't find a clean buffer. It has to flush the data that's in that buffer. So we want client backends to be doing zero writes. We want the checkpointer and the background writer to be taking care of this for them so that when you do a read, you're not doing a write first. So in this example, we're seeing a background writer is doing some writes, but maybe it could be doing more. So we have some options there. Background writer historically has a certain throughput cap that's relatively low. So if you have a super, you know, fast, like high throughput workload, then maybe background writer is not going to be able to help you. But you can decrease the background writer delay. You can increase background writer LRU max pages. I won't get into the specific mechanics of those GUCs, but there's articles online you can look at, background writer tuning, that kind of thing. So, and then a lot of times though, like let's take this case, shared buffers is too small. A lot of people are, if you have the ability to change shared buffers, because of course you need to restart and everything, a lot of times that's going to help with your IO problem. So in this example, in contrast, if you look at the number of reads for client backend in the normal context and the number of writes for client backend in normal context, there's almost one write for every read. So that's bad. That's a bad sign. That means most likely we are evicting and rereading in the same blocks over and over. And you see evictions as high. You know, after the first time that we've gotten everything off the free list and we've used every buffer at least once, everything is going to be an eviction after that. So, but in this case, because we're seeing reads and writes be very proportionate, that's like a hint that, hey, or a signal that it may be necessary to increase shared buffers. Our primary working set just isn't fitting. And you can see that with our cache hit ratio too, it's around 60% when we look at the client backend normal hits and reads. And just a simple cache hit ratio query for client backends doing things in the normal context with permanent relations, you can calculate the cache hit ratio this way. On the other hand, you want to avoid premature optimization. So one of the things that was really hard before pgstat.io was actually calculating your cache hit ratio if you have any sort of other types of IO than your very standard transactional workload going on. So in this example, you can see that client backend normal context reads pretty low. Looks like we read in our working set and then the hits are really high. We just keep reusing those blocks and, you know, everything seems like it's kind of going okay in terms of that. But you can tell that the number of client backend bulk reads is really high. We also have a fair number of auto vacuum reads. So what you can see there is if those were all together, if they weren't separated by backend type and context, then we would actually calculate a pretty incorrect cache hit ratio. And I'll show you what that would look like if we used pgstat database to calculate the cache hit ratio here. We'd get about 45%. And that's similar to if you use pgstat.io without a where clause. But what we care about is tuning for our regular workload. So once we add in the where clause where the client is back, where the backend type is a client backend, it's in the normal context, it's a permanent no temp relations, our cache hit ratio is basically 99%. I mean, we definitely don't need to increase shared buffers for this. So I think pgstat.io gives you the additional information that you need to avoid these kinds of premature optimizations. So what's next for pgstat.io? So hopefully in Postgres 17, we're going to add, there's a category of missing IO that I think would be really good to add, which is all the IO that's outside of shared buffers and outside of local buffers. So things like if you do, you know, there's certain operations like create index where it's doing a lot of IO sort of directly. We're calling it bypass IO. Also per connection IO stats, so taking pgstat.io, separating out per connection, and then integrating pgstat wall, the information that's there, into pgstat.io and sort of streamlining it so there's a single source of truth for your IO information. I will be answering questions on Discord, so I'd love to hear about your use cases, your questions, and I'm just really excited for people to use the Vue in Postgres 16 and tell me what they think.
That was wonderful. Thank you, Melanie, for being here. I have a question for you. For someone who's really familiar with pgstat statements, when should they think about using pgstat.io versus pgstat statements?
Right. So pgstat statements is still going to be your go-to when you care about per statement, per query information. So if you kind of already know, like, this query is really slow, then you want to use pgstat statements for sure.
Okay.
So the other thing I think people always wonder about with, you know, IO related tooling and Postgres, and specifically in this case, so once this is out there, like presumably I'll see something if I'm in a cloud provider, like I'll be able to actually get some data because the underlying stuff is often hard to understand.
Right. Yeah. So that's the great thing about pgstat.io is that it will, on any cloud provider, unless they restrict it for some reason, you'll be able to see it. We have put all the collection points in a place where it doesn't matter what the underlying storage type is or anything like that. So it'll just work on any cloud provider.
Awesome.
So I know you just committed pgstat.io to Postgres 16. I'm just curious what's next for you in Postgres. Are you going to continue to work in observability or?
I think that one of the things that I'm really excited about is Postgres 15 actually changed the underlying statistics system to use shared memory. And the way that it is now, it's much more reliable and adding new statistics is a lot easier and sort of straightforward. So what I'd really love to see is users who are not, you know, necessarily full-time Postgres contributors, but know what their use cases are for them to add new statistics. And so like, I'm excited to review more patches around observability. I know some of the folks at Dalibo proposed some exciting new statistics around parallel query for Postgres 17. Bilal, one of my coworkers here who did a Citus Con talk on CI, he's thinking about working on some of the items the open items that I listed. So I think like the goal is to have you know, people that are using Postgres being like every single day, you know, in the trenches, adding the new observability statistics.
Awesome. And people can reach you obviously today during the event on Discord if they have questions. And then more generally, if someone watches this talk on YouTube in 3 months and they have an idea for some statistics or feedback on observability, how do they reach you?
Well, you can tweet at me. I'm not like that prolific, so I will probably answer. But I think the best thing to do would be on the hackers mailing list. You can either email me directly or you can send an email to the hackers mailing list and propose your idea and sort of don't be afraid to like put a, don't be afraid to email the hackers mailing list because you have a higher chance that people will respond. And if you want help like composing your email, because I know it can be intimidating, I'm happy to help people with formatting and wording.
Awesome. Well, I'm so glad that you had this time on your schedule and the ability to come and give the talk today. Thank you very much, Melanie.
Thank you.
I also wanted to say that people who have feedback on your talk or any of the other talks, we've been popping a banner up with the aka.ms URL to fill out the attendee survey. And you can fill it out multiple times. So, you know, on the talks you've seen in today's live stream, tomorrow's EMEA live stream, the on-demand talks, it's open until next Friday the 28th or something. Cool.